province of the kingdom have to wear, both near and far, obliging them to keep the 14th day of the month Adar, and also the 15th day of the same year, of the same year by year, as the day on which the Jews got relief from their enemies, and as the month that had been turned for them from sorrow into gladness, and from mourning into a holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days for sending gifts of food to one another and gifts to the poor. So the Jews accepted what they had started to do and what Mordecai had written to them. For Haman the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha, the enemy of all the Jews, had plotted against the Jews to destroy them, and had cast pur, that is, cast lots, to crush and to destroy them. But when it came before the king, he gave orders in writing that his evil plan that he had devised against the Jews should return on his own head, and that he and his sons should be hanged on the gallows. Therefore, they called these days Purim, after the term Pur. Therefore, because of all that was written in this letter, and of what they had faced in this matter, and of what had happened to them, the Jews firmly obligated themselves and their offspring, and all who joined them, that without fail they would keep these 2 days according to what was written, and at the time appointed every year, that these days should be remembered and kept throughout every generation and every clan, province, and city, and that these days of Purim should never fall into disuse among the Jews, nor should the commemoration of these days cease among their descendants. Let's pray. Gracious Father, I pray as we look one final time at this story of redemption and renewal and deliverance, Lord, that you would stir our hearts to rejoice in your provision for our lives, that you grant to us each and every day when we wake up, when we breathe the air, as we are able to worship you and dwell in fellowship with you and other believers. I pray, Lord, that we would rejoice and respond by living our lives for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Just kind of give a snapshot of Esther. It begins in telling us the story of how King Ahasuerus was in his palace and basically showing his opulence, showing off all of his goods, his wealth, and he partied for day after day after day after day, calling a feast. I believe it was a 7-day feast, and when he was high in spirits and on wine and so forth, he wanted to call in his queen, Vashti, to show her off before everybody else, show her beauty, showing off his wealth and his magnificence. Why not show off his wife, he thought. And so he tried to do that. The queen decided that she wasn't going to go forward with that and not come in that way. And so got upset with her, and she was no longer queen. We come to chapter 2, and we begin the search for a new queen, and some of his advisors thought it would be a good idea to have a beauty pageant. And they had already advised him to write a command that wives should obey and submit to their husbands across the whole kingdom, and marriages were safe throughout all of Persia. No, not really, so they'd already kind of not given some great advice to the king, but he thought it'd be a good idea, so they had this beauty pageant with a young Jewish lady by the name of Hadassah, better known as Esther, wins the pageant. She comes before the king, and she is named Queen Esther. Around this time, she has a cousin named Mordecai, who uncovers a plot, and in uncovering this plot to kill the emperor, we never find that he is rewarded for this. And in fact, if we read the story, the next chapter, we see, in fact, Haman, the Agagite, rose to power. And if you know a little bit about the story between Agagite and Mordecai, there's a bit of background there. The Agagites were from the line of the Philistines and going all the way back to Esau, whereas Mordecai was from the line of Benjamin, also in the line of King Saul. They didn't have a good history together already. Before any of this ever happened, they didn't have a good history. Might have been part of the reason that Mordecai didn't want to bow to Haman. So Haman doesn't really like this guy named Mordecai, and Mordecai didn't really like this guy named Haman, and so we had this conflict emerge, because like I won't bow down to Haman. Like he's supposed to. So Haman can't have a good day if this guy's not going to bow down to him. So he decides just to wipe out all Jews everywhere. Okay? Maybe a bit of an overreaction, but that's what sets the story in motion. Okay? And so he cast lots, per, as it's called in the book of Esther, and it lands on the 14th or 13th day of Adar, and he decides that's the day I'm going to destroy the Jews. He goes before the king, he gets this royal edict that on this day they're going to wipe the Jews off the map, basically. Mordecai goes to Esther. He says, Esther, you've got to go before the king and plead on behalf of your people. She said, I can't do that. If I go before the king and he doesn't summon me, he'll kill me. And he says, you're going to die either way. You might as well get it your best shot. And so she says, if I perish, I perish. She called a fast. The people prayed. She goes before the king on behalf of her people. He allows her to come in and says, I'll give you anything you ask for up to half of my kingdom. I just said, thank you very much. And I just said that. Let's move on with it. But she says, well, in fact, I'd like to invite you to a banquet tomorrow, you and Haman. And so Esther, King Ahasuerus, and Haman are all at this banquet. And the king keeps asking her, what is it that you want? What do you want from me? And she said, tell you what, because she's a good Southern Baptist, she asked him back again the next day for a meal, okay? Because, anyway. So another banquet. So Haman is invited to this one as well. So he leaves this meeting, and he's feeling really good about himself, okay? So I've already had one banquet with the king and queen of the most powerful nation on earth, and now I've been invited back a second time, and man, he is on cloud nine. His feet aren't even touching the ground. He's on his way back to the house, and there's Mordecai. He sees Mordecai, and of course Mordecai doesn't bow to him, and he ruins a perfectly good day. And so maybe a little bit of an overreaction, but Haman goes home and he builds the gallows, okay, to hang Mordecai on. Now, I don't know if you've ever had a bad day and been upset with someone. Probably not to the extent where you went home and built a gallows to hang them on the next day. Maybe you have, if so, I don't want to know you. But anyway, I hope I never upset you. But so that's what he does. And so then he goes back and the next day he's kind of close to the king's quarters, and that night the emperor could not sleep. He could not sleep, and so he had some of the chronicles read to him, some of the records read to him, and he hears the story of Mordecai, and he asks, well, was he ever rewarded? And he said, no. And so he thinks, well, what can I do for Mordecai to reward him since he hasn't been rewarded? And as he's thinking, just so happens that Haman is available. But he doesn't know he's thinking about Mordecai when the king calls him in and asks, what should I do to honor the person in whom the king delights? Haman, thinking it's himself, he goes big, okay? He's thinking, get a royal steed, put your royal robe, let's have a parade, let's make this big. And he said, great, go find Mordecai because that's the guy I want to honor. And so, to his own humiliation, here's Haman leading Mordecai in this parade with Mordecai on the royal steed with a royal robe, and Haman is leading him in this parade to his own humiliation. Maybe a foreshadowing of what's about to happen. Because now we get to that banquet, and Mordecai and Haman, King Ahasuerus, and Esther are all there, and finally the king asks, what do you want to ask of me, Esther? And she says, I am pleading for my life. Please save my people. This Haman has plotted to kill my people. The king, in a rage, goes out. And while he's out, Haman's pleading for his life. The king comes back in, and long story short, Haman is hung on the very gallows that he had set up for Mordecai. So now the king puts forth this edict that on that day in which all the Jewish people were going to die, that on that day, the Jews would fight for themselves, basically reversing the edict and granting victory to the Jewish people. Through Esther and Mordecai, God saved the Jewish people, delivering them from certain death. As we've seen over the past several weeks, as we're going to talk a little bit more about today, Esther and Mordecai were not models and are not models for us to follow in terms of their religious zeal, their love for the Lord. They are not models. They are imperfect people. And yet we see here and many, many, many other places in the Bible where God accomplishes something absolutely breathtaking through imperfect people. And one of the main lines that we want to get across to you this morning and throughout this series is you need to understand these are not immortal. These are mere mortals. They put on their pants the same way that you do. They're human beings. They're not superheroes. They don't have superpowers. They're imperfect people. They're not perfect in any sense of the word, and yet God accomplished great things through them. He can do the same through each one of us. Today I want to talk about how to grow in our loyalty to God by remembering four divine provisions found in the book of Esther. So we're going to talk about growing in our loyalty to God by remembering four divine provisions found in the book of Esther. Provision number one is deliverance. Deliverance. We see in chapter 9, verse 23 through 28, this installment of a new holiday for the Jewish people called Purim, in which they would celebrate this holiday from that year forth in order to remember what God had done for them in delivering them. You know, right now, of course, a lot of people are in the midst of observing Lent, and you had Ash Wednesday and whatnot. And I'll never forget a story my cousin told me about someone at work who was observing Lent, and she said, well, she knew that she was observing Lent. She said, okay, well, what are you fasting from? I'm fasting from steak. And she said, steak? You don't even like steak. She said, well, yeah, I'm not going to fast from something I like. So right now, I'm fasting from Diet Coke, just so you know. But, kind of not getting the right idea for what it was intended for. Sometimes we have a tendency with holidays to kind of move away from the central purpose and meaning of the holiday. Enter Christmas, where a lot of times we just think Christmas is about gifts and presents and St. Nick and all that sort of stuff, and we sometimes move off center with some of those things, the Easter Bunny, eggs. Nothing wrong with any of those things, I don't think, but it is oftentimes a reflection if you ask a kid, what's this holiday about, and that's the first thing that comes to their mind, that's the first thing that comes to some of our minds as well, is a picture of how we move off center. Holidays are intended to help us remember. Turn over with me, if you would, to Exodus chapter 12. Talk about another very similar holiday in Jewish life. Exodus chapter 12, verse 21. Moses had gone through 9 of the 10 plagues, and this last one was going to be the straw that broke the camel's back, so to speak. And God knew that he was about to lead them out after this last plague from Egyptian bondage. And so, even beforehand, he begins to install this holiday. Now, you got to love the fact that the holiday is installed to remember something that God is about to do. Hadn't even done it yet, okay? The 10th plague is about to come, and they're setting up this whole holiday on something that hadn't even happened yet. That's kind of how God works. We ought to have a holiday for the second coming of Christ because it's going to happen, all right? It hadn't happened yet. It's going to happen. And so he's setting up this whole holiday about something that hadn't even happened yet, but the purpose is to remember. Look at chapter 12, verse 21. Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, go and select lambs for yourselves according to your clans and kill the Passover lamb. Take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin and touch the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of the door of this house until the morning, for the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your house to strike you. You shall observe this rite as a statute for you and for your sons forever. And when you come to the land that the Lord will give you, and remind you, this is years down the road, when you come to the land that the Lord will give you, as he has promised, you shall keep this service. And when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? You shall say, it is a sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, for he has passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians, but spared our houses, and the people bowed their heads and worshiped. Why did they set this in motion? Just to have a good time? No, that might have been part of the picture here, but bottom line is so that they would remember God's deliverance, that they would remember the salvation they got from the Lord. That is the purpose of a holiday, of a holy day, to set it apart so that we might remember the work of God. And in Esther, one of the main reasons he wrote this book is so that, one of the main reasons this book was written was so that they would remember why Purim was instituted. Of course, Purim comes from Pur, when lots were cast by Haman, when he put a day on the calendar to destroy the Jewish people. And this book was written to remember God's act of salvation, which ought to cause us to celebrate, ought to cause them to celebrate. As believers, we observe something called the ordinances, baptism, and the Lord's Supper. Why do we do those things? We do those things to remember, particularly the Lord's Supper. Jesus says, this do in remembrance of me. So we, every time we observe the Lord's Supper, we are to reflect back on Jesus and what he accomplished on the cross in order to deliver us. And if we keep that in our minds, that we are a delivered, a saved people, that renews the way that you think every day that you wake up. If you wake up knowing that God has delivered you and I from certain demise, then that helps us grow in our loyalty to God. Number two provision is victory. Victory. Chapter 9, the first 19 verses or so, gives a picture of this reverse. I'll just read the first verse here. It says, now in the 12th month, which is the month of Adar, on the 13th day of the same, when the king's command and edict were about to be carried out, on the very day when the enemies of the Jews hoped to gain mastery over them, the reverse occurred, and the Jews gained mastery over those who hated them. You need to understand that the Jewish people were not a beloved people in the Persian kingdom. Their way of life was different than everybody else. They were monotheists, so they didn't believe in all the gods that everybody else believed in. They observed the Sabbath, so they took a day, whereas back in those days, you didn't do that. They took a day just to rest and not labor, and that was a totally different way of doing things in Persia. They had other religious observances that set them apart. And because of that, Haman and many others did not really care for them all that much, and his plan to annihilate them was basically received with some support. But on top of that, it was fully understandable, and they were totally capable as Persians of destroying them. I mean, they're a small Jewish nation within the great empire of Persia, not even a nation at this point really anymore. And so they're within this large empire, and they have a day on the calendar marked for their destruction. And it says, I like that for them, the very day that they were sent to be destroyed, God did just the opposite of that. God has a tendency to work in this way. You know, watching the Super Bowl, there was a point in time in the Super Bowl where it was laughable to suggest I know because I made that suggestion. People laughed, okay? Anyway, we'll get into that. But and so it was kind of laughable, and then all of a sudden it wasn't laughable anymore. And I'll never forget seeing this article. And it was when the Falcons were way up. They were just scoring points, whatnot. And there was a jubilant Atlanta Falcon player on the sideline, and he was kind of getting in that spirit of celebration, and when the guy next to him said, yeah, it's Tom Brady, though. It's Tom Brady, though. And, of course, you know the rest of the story. And as I thought about that, I thought, you know, just about any, on a much greater scale, as we read stories like this, where God's people are in the jaws of the enemy. They're about to be destroyed. The most powerful nation on earth, the second most powerful man in that nation, has put them on the calendar to take them out. And I just think to myself, but it's God, then. Even Haman's wife said, if Mordecai, before whom you have begun to fall, is of the Jewish people, you will not overcome him, but will surely fall before him. Even she knew, you're not going to win this battle. God has a tendency of winning battles in dramatic fashion. He could snap his fingers and bring us out, but he wants us to remember. He wants us to look back and not forget his provision, his grace, his mercy. How with 300 men, Gideon, you're going to win. How, hey, Jonah, you're in the belly of a whale or a great fish. I'm going to get you out of this, and you're going to go before Nineveh, who's a pagan nation, and you're going to preach, and they're going to repent and believe what you have to say. Esther is a young Jewish peasant girl in the most powerful nation on earth at that point, and God is going to rise her up, raise her up to the place of power where she delivers her people, where God delivers his people through her. It's God, though. And when we look at the story of the gospel, and we see Jesus, and we see a man who is born in Bethlehem to a group of parents, to a couple of parents who were poor, grew up in Nazareth. What good comes from Nazareth? We see that he grew up in poverty, lived an obscure life as an itinerant minister and preacher and teacher, had no fame or fortune to speak of. And yet, today, we remember him and know him as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, because God has a tendency to bring victory into situations that say he could never do that. And yet that's how God works time after time after time again. The third provision, joy. I want you to look at chapter 9, verse 19. It says, verse 17 says, this is on the 13th day of the month of Adar, and on the 14th day they rested, and made that a day of feasting and gladness. Let's get down to verse 20. And Mordecai reported these things, and sent letters to all the Jews who were in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus, both near and far, obliging them to keep the 14th day of the month, Adar, and also the 15th of the same year by year, as the days on which the Jews got relief from their enemies, and as the month that had been turned for them from sorrow into gladness, and from mourning into a holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days of sending gifts of food to one another and gifts to the poor. How many of you growing up, now in Texas this is a big deal, how many of you growing up, when you would wake up on a school day, and you look outside, and you see it snowing, and you look on the television, and suddenly, because we live in Texas, and there's snow, school's canceled, right? And you're a kid, and what happens? Your day, maybe you had a big test that day, and you were stressing, and you know it's going to be bad, you're just stressed out about it, and suddenly you wake up, and you've got another day, and not only that, you've got a snow day. And man, you're jumping up, joy and gladness, and your mourning has turned into a holiday. On a much greater scale, that's what we see in the book of Esther. God brings joy into the midst of mourning. He brings his people joy. And what I love about this, setting up a holiday just to rejoice and party. We serve the most joyful being on earth, in the universe. Our God is a joyful, joyful being. And he loves for his kids, for his children to rejoice in him. He ordained this holiday to rejoice and to remember his provision. I like something that John Piper said, God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. Their story is our story. And that's one of the big points we've got to get across here before the series is over. Their story stories of deliverance and victory and salvation in the Old Testament are mere shadows and pale reflections of what's about to happen in the New Testament with Jesus. Because the reality is, you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked, following the course of this world, under the prince of the power of the air. You are under the grasp of sin, death, and Satan. There was a day marked on the calendar. You don't know what day it is. There's a day marked on the calendar when we will breathe our last on this earth. And before you knew Christ, that was a day of great gloom and sadness. Not for everybody mourning your loss, but for you. Because you're dead in your trespasses and sins. But you know what the Bible says in Ephesians 2? But God. But God. Being rich in mercy, being rich in grace, delivers us, makes us alive together with Jesus Christ, and seats us in the heavenlies with Him. God provides for us this everlasting joy. And just like when you wake up on the school day and suddenly it's not a school day, it's a snow day, and you rejoice, just like when Israel, when the Jewish people woke up one day, and not only are they not going to be annihilated, they are going to have victory over their enemies. They have been delivered. They have been saved. And just like you would expect them to rejoice and to celebrate, how much more should we rejoice and celebrate on Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, remembering that the first day of the week, God raised His beloved Son from the dead, proving victory over sin, death, and Satan. And that's not something we celebrate every year. That's something we celebrate every single week. That's why on the first day, wonder why it's not the seventh day anymore. Why is it the first day? Because it was on that day that Jesus rose up from the dead, proving His victory over sin, death, and Satan. And we ought to be the most joyful people on earth. Through the Spirit, it's joy. I love how in the Gospel of John, and we're going to get to this last point and wrap it up here, but I love how in the Gospel of John, in chapter 14, verse 13, Jesus says, talking about prayer, and He says, whatever you ask in My name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Why is He going to do that? So that the Father might be glorified in the Son. But then just a couple of chapters over, in chapter 16, verse 24, He says pretty much the same thing. He says, until now you have asked nothing in My name. Ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full. God's glory and our joy are not opposed to one another. In fact, they're directly linked. That's why I like the statement, God is most glorified in us and we are most satisfied in Him. Finally, the last provision, mercy. Mercy. When we come to Esther chapter 10, we see stability, we see rest. Can you imagine having on the calendar your destruction? Can you imagine? We can't, I don't think, most of us. We can't imagine what it's like to have a day set aside just for the destruction of our people. And can you imagine when you get on the other side of that and there's rest and there's stability? We see in Esther chapter 10 this picture of Mordecai. So King Ahasuerus imposed tax on the land and on the coastlands of the sea. And all the acts of his power and might and the full account of the high honor of Mordecai to which the king advanced him, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Media and Persia? So Mordecai the Jew was second in rank to King Ahasuerus. And he was great among the Jews and popular with the multitude of his brothers, for he sought the welfare of his people and spoke peace to his people. He rose up to take the very place that Haman had in the nation. Why? Did he deserve it? Did he do anything to deserve that? No. It was by God's grace and His mercy. And that's why when we read in Ephesians chapter 2 about how we were dead in our trespasses and sins, but God has made us alive together with Christ, it doesn't end there. It actually continues on and says this. It says, But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you've been saved, and listen to this, and raised us up and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. So just like King Ahasuerus thought it'd be a good idea to show off his magnificence before everybody else, in the end, God will show his greatness. And the Bible says, every knee will bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And that day, there will be no denying who God is. His greatness will be revealed so mightily. God raises us up and seats us with him, kind of like he raised Mordecai, kind of like he raised Esther in an earthly way, in a much more heavenly sense. God raises us up and seats us with him in the heavenly places, not because of anything about us that we can do, but simply by the richness of his grace. We will be trophies of God's grace for all eternity. But here's the thing. Only to those who repent and believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's bow as we close our eyes. And for the next few, we come to the end of this story of Esther. We've seen God's providence. We've seen God working through imperfect people. We've seen God's mercy on display. And you may be at different points in the journey. Each and every one of us are at different points in the journey. Maybe you've never received the gospel of Jesus Christ and experienced the joy. Maybe you grew up thinking it's all about do's and don'ts and do this, don't do that, and certain religious observances that you had to follow. Maybe that's what you thought Christianity was all about. But let me just say that the story of the Bible, that old, old story about Jesus and his love, that he died on the cross in that place in our sins, that God raised him up, and he is seated reigning over all the universe. And one day he is returning to gather his people. And the question is this morning, do you believe in him? Do you trust him? Have you given your life to him? If not, I invite you this morning to trust in Jesus as Lord and Savior. Maybe you're at a different point in your journey. Maybe you just always thought, God can't use me in the church because I'm too imperfect. If you knew all the things, that all the baggage that I've got, you'd never want to use me in the church. But God works through imperfect people all the time. He worked through Esther, through Mordecai, through Moses, through Jonah. He worked through the disciples. He's working through people in this congregation right now who would fully and gladly admit that they're imperfect. They've got flaws. I've got flaws. Some days I wake up and I wonder to myself, you're a pastor. But God uses imperfect people to accomplish great things for him. Our response, again, is faith, trusting in him, walking in faithfulness and loyalty to him. Gracious Father, I pray over our congregation today for someone here who's needing to trust in Jesus today in heaven. Lord, that they would commit their sins and follow after you. I pray for someone here who's kind of remained on the edges of church life, or maybe they, today's the first time they've been in church in a while. I pray today, Father, that you would convict their hearts, that you use them perfectly. They can be used by you. And so, Father, I pray today that we would be loyal.